Good morning. Good morning, St. Paul. Good morning, everybody. Amen. Everybody awake? Amen. Amen. We praise God here. Amen. And we thank God that you're here with us at St. Paul Missionary Baptist Church. And as you see, our theme for this year is Reaching More in 2024. And that begins with me, amen. And as you see on the board, we come to celebrate, amen, our pastor, amen. But we also come, most importantly, to celebrate Jesus Christ, amen. Amen, we come to lift Jesus Christ up, amen, that he may draw all men unto himself, amen. Amen, we thank God for our pastor, amen, the Reverend Dr. Michael A. Polk, Sr. We thank God for Reverend Andrew McDavid, Sr., amen, our assistant pastor, our associate minister, Reverend Jimmy McKnight, and our very own minister, Gabriel John Gorby, and also one of our new members, amen, Reverend Lance, amen, amen. And we just want to have a brief call to worship with you today, amen, because we know we are excited about what God is going to do in this place, amen. Amen. Our call to worship today. Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Declare his glory among the heathen and his wonders among all people. Give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name, and bring an offering and come into his courts. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness and fear before him all the earth. Amen. Amen. And we thank God for that word. Amen. That we can worship him in the beauty of holiness. Amen. Amen. And before we get started with our program for today, we just want to share with you a few announcements. Amen. Amen. And you see on the screen there, and we would love to have you there, or the First Presbyterian Church of St. Albans would love to have you there. Amen. Join us for the Nativity Quest. They're having a vacation Bible school there at First Presbyterian Church of St. Albans, starting at June the 10th through the 14th, 5:30. Amen. It's the start time there. Amen. Amen. And we here at St. Paul, we will have our vacation Bible school, and I want to encourage everybody, it's for all ages. Amen. July the 15th through the 19th, starting at 5 p.m. Amen. And registration has already begun. You can register either online, or we have some paper forms that you can use. Amen. They're in the vestibule there if you would like to get one. And we want to encourage you to invite your children to come out as well as the adults, amen? Amen. And we also have on our screen today, Friends and Family and Fellowship, amen, Sunday, amen? And that is the last Sunday of June, June 30th, in the Fellowship Hall. We had a wonderful time. The first one we had a few months ago, amen? It's going to be your favorite soups and desserts, amen. And we want to encourage you to invite people out on that Sunday, every Sunday, amen. But down on that Sunday also, amen. Friends and family and fellowship, amen. 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 And we thank God again for our pastor's anniversary, amen. And this is a time when you can get your hands good and warm, amen. 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 We always do a hand check here in the sanctuary. Amen. For all those who are here today. Amen. We pray that you came with expectations. Amen. That God is going to do something special in this place today. Amen. 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 As we open up our anniversary program, we're going to ask you to everyone to stand. Amen. And we're going to sing, amen, as our pastor and first lady are escorted in by Sister Annette Jones and Brother Hewlin Jones. We're going to sing Bless the Lord, Oh My Soul. Amen. That's for the whole congregation to sing. Amen. Let this be your testimony. Amen. Amen. Let's sing, bless the Lord, bless the Lord.
God, that we can bless the Lord
going to turn the rest of the service over to Minister Gabriel Gorby. He will be your MC. Amen. And we praise God in the sanctuary. Amen. Amen.
For joining us here to celebrate on such a wonderful day, and just thank you to Brother Reverend Clifford for being here this morning, and all the other ministers in the house this morning. Thank you. At this time, I would like to invite Dr. Andre Kohler up to bring us our welcome.
Good morning, everyone. Excuse me for being a little slow, but I couldn't not be here on a day like this. If my doctor's watching, forgive me. I'm honored to stand with you today as a member of the anniversary committee, and I'm thankful to our Lord Jesus Christ for enabling us to come together as we celebrate 23 years.
Amen.
And not just 23 years of being, but 23 years of love and leadership.
Amen.
From Pastor and Sister Pope. Amen. To those who may not have been with us at St. Paul before, whether here presently or online, we know that you stop being a visitor the moment you hit the door, press the button. Mm-hmm. You're now part of the family.
Amen.
We're thankful that you thought it not robbery to join us today, and we hope to see you again, because this is a great place to be.
Amen.
For
Amen.
Members and regular attendees, I know that you are as excited as I am for this wonderful celebration. Mm-hmm. Thank you all, and may today be a blessing to you as we honor God and recognize how God has empowered the Pokes to serve for these 23 years and more. Thank you.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, sister. Thank you very much. That was a very warm welcome indeed. Praise God. Praise God. And at this time, as we know the ministry is going forward, I would like to invite our youngins, our youth ministry, up for our youth presentation.
Good morning, St. Paul. Good morning, St. Paul. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. You know, one of the things I really appreciate hearing from Pastor Polk is that we have this ministry. What does that mean? That's a big umbrella. Because believe it or not, we are all called into ministry. Bus ministry, kitchen ministry, choir, but the youth ministry. That's what we're here to talk about today. You know, I grew up in a church, and one of the first things that I remember doing, they taught me how to sing this song, and it said, I know we have mountains that we think we cannot climb. Y'all know that song. Y'all know that song. Anybody ever have a mountain in front of them? It don't sound like a real church in here. Anybody have a mountain in front of them? All right. Keep living if you have not. At some point, there's going to be a mountain. There's some type of wind of adversity that's going to come against you. How are you going to approach it? Pastor, Sister Pope, their leadership, from their teaching, from the way they live their life, is saying a lot to our young people. Don't be afraid of the mountain, because the faith of a mustard seed can move that mountain. So on behalf of our youth, we just wanted to say thank you. And this is just something, a little something that we put together to say thank you. There's some DJ issues. Hold on. You know what? We're going to do it the way. We'll get it done. We'll get it done. Ready? One of the special things that we did as a theme for every mountain, the youth said they wanted to draw a portrait for you, paint a portrait for you. So on behalf of our youth department, we want to honor you. Thank you for helping us tackle our future mountains by everything that you've poured into us to know that God is with us always. And our youth department's theme is forever changed. For we know when we accept God, We're not walking by ourselves. Our lives are forever changed. So if we can have a special photo with Pastor Polk, Sister Polk, with our youth.
Actually work very, very hard and very diligently on that. So they are really just such wonderful children, and it's such a blessing to get to do the ministry with them, and so excited for what God will continually do through them. Amen. Amen. And at this time, we will go a little higher in our praise with our time of offering. I would ask the deacons to come forward to receive it on this morning.
Williams, if he would help assist us. Special basket for right. Pastor's anniversaries offerings, amen. And we'll show you that here in a moment, amen.
Cheerful giver. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Let us bow our heads for prayer over the offering before we come to receive it.
Amen.
Father God, Holy One of Israel, we come boldly before you this morning thanking you for all the provisions you have made for our lives. Each day that we wake up, you supply us once again. You keep us warm. You keep our stomachs full. You provide everything that our families need, our children, Lord, our parents, our grandparents. Lord, you watch over us each and every single day. And right now, we just want to come before you and give you the blessings that you've already given to us. And Lord, may they be magnified and go out to your kingdom to help those who are needy and the poor. And Lord, let it be magnified to glorify your kingdom above all else. And Lord, we love you, we praise you, we thank you once again. And it is in Christ Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Amen.
we move into our next presentation, a slideshow of Down Through the Years, I would like to invite Brother Deacon Law to share a few words.
Amen. And all of my excitement, amen. We forgot to tell you what the theme was, amen. But it's listed on your program, amen. Amen. And the theme for this year is For Every Mountain, You Brought Me Over, I Give You Praise. Amen. That's a song by Kurt Carr, amen. And we, the Pastoral Anniversary Committee, amen, felt it so appropriate in this hour, in this season of life, that God is going to see you through and bring you over that mountain, amen? And as we see, as we go into our, over the years, amen, through the years, amen, presentation today, we're going to play a little bit of that song as you see the slide presentation, amen. Let the song minister to you, amen, and then the next voice you will hear following this presentation will be that of your MC once again. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Blessings and so many open doors of mercy.
Hold it, that's why I
Kirk Franklin. Amen. And we have more. Amen. Amen. Put our hands together, amen. Amen. That was Down Through the Years, the short version, amen. Because you know 23 years, we couldn't put it all on the board, amen. But we thank God for our media departments, especially Sister Paula Sims, who helped us put that slide presentation together. And we just come to praise God and thank God for the man and woman of God today. Amen. Amen. Yes.
Praise God for the ministry led by Pastor and Miss Polk. And I just have to comment, out of all those pictures, did you notice that in 23 years, they're the only people that hasn't aged a bit? Not even a day. God is good. God is good. And at this time, I would like to ask my brother Aiden Johnson to prepare himself as we come forward to sing a song. Last time we got to sing this as a trio. Sadly, this time we will have to sing it as a duo. Brother Jacob could not join us on today, but let the Lord be with us and let us praise the Lord together. Amen. Amen. In His spirit.
Hello.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. My God fights for me.
Amen. Ever done for us.
you, Lord, for saving us. Thank you, Lord, for just keeping us through times and trials, even though we didn't deserve it, even though we didn't believe, you still kept us all the way through. And, you know, you'll never let us go. And so we appreciate that, God, and we praise you on this Sunday. Are you trapped and can't get out?
Or are you staring down a lion's mouth?
What's your story here today?
And what's the giant standing in your way?
Can you stand before the Lord?
Or do you need to hit the floor? It doesn't matter what you've done, because the battle is already won. Jacob shall be with us, right? Next time, Jacob shall be with us. Amen. And now, before we hear a musical selection and our speaker, guest speaker today, Reverend Clifford Sherrod, I would like to hand it over to Reverend McDavid for the introduction of the speaker.
Amen. Let the church say amen. Amen. Oh, my goodness. God fights for me. I'm telling you. Right? You ain't never got in a fight until you get one and let God take your battles. I'm telling you. It's something. But thank God for Reverend Gorby, Mr. Gorby, and Mr. Aiden Johnson. Oh, we thank God for them. I mean, we thank God for them. God, I know they was a little bit nervous, but you know, God always come through.
Always.
I'm telling you, if you ain't nervous, you know, if you're not nervous, then something's wrong. Because that means if you are nervous, you depend on God.
Amen.
So when it's all over with, mm-hmm. when God comes through for you, you know it wasn't you.
That's it.
It was God. Amen?
Amen?
Oh, man, I got the easiest job in the world right now. Introduce the Reverend Cliff Allen Sherrod. Well, I tell you, we go way back in so many ways. I remember when I told Jerry, I said, the Lord had called me to preach. And in the second verse, Jerry said back to me, Cliff accepted the Lord to preach too. I said, what? So we was all about the same time. And God, that's the way God is. I mean, that's the way he does things. And we've been blessed. You've been blessed, and I'm known for getting off the script, but I'm gonna try to stick with this one. So as it's been stated, that Clifford Sherrod Sr. was born September 23rd, 1949, to the late Reverend Henry Sherrod and Inez Sherrod in Leslie, West Virginia. He is the sixth of nine children born to this union. Cliff grew up in a Christian home and as a result accepted Christ at an early age at Rome Baptist Church. His parents, leading by example, taught him that only what you do for Christ will last. So he willingly labored and actively participated in the events at his home church. When he came to Charleston as a recent graduate of Crichton High School, he united with Liberty Baptist Church in Charleston. Later, he joined St. Paul Missionary Baptist Church in St. Albans, where he raised his voice in song with the St. Paul male chorus, and we remember every bit of that, every year of it. It's been a blessing to us. And as a member of First Baptist Church, he discovered he had a love for teaching and was a dedicated Sunday school teacher to young adults. He knew he had more of the Lord's work to do, and he was eventually ordained as a deacon there. Levi First Missionary Baptist Church is where he now calls his spiritual home. It is there that he answered the call to preach the gospel. Also, Reverend Cliff C. Rod pastored Community Missionary Baptist Church in Charleston for 4.5 years. And talking to anyone, this is what he usually do, talking to anyone, especially young people, about the love of Christ. Yes. This was his favorite pastime. And following a close second is his enthusiasm to visit the sick and shut in and share the gospel with them. Cliff completed studies at the United Electronics Institute, was employed as an electrician with Appalachian Electric Power Company. He is now at home enjoying his retirement. A dedicated family man, Cliff is the husband of Terry Carper Chiron. He is also the father of 7 and the fun-loving grandfather of 7. He reminds us that as a servant of God, and y'all remember this song, he's just a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody. Amen. The next voice you will hear would be the Reverend Clifford Allen Sherrod. And when he comes, please give him your applause and your prayers. Amen.
And now, Brother Jerry Sherrod will come up and sing a selection, I Won't Complain.
We changed up here the last minute, but that's okay because, you know. God has been good to us. Robin. I've had some good days. I've had some weary days. But when I look around, And I think things over. All of my good days, I weigh my bad days. I won't complain. Sometimes the clouds hang low, I can hardly see. I ask the question why. So much pain. He dries all my tears away. Turn my midnight into day. So I say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Oh, I thank you. I won't complain. God has been good to me. Been so good to me, more than this whole world could ever be. Lord, He dries all my tears away. Turn our midnights into day. So I'll just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, I thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. I won't complain. Oh, God's been good to me. So good to me, more than this old world could ever be. The Lord, He dries all my tears away. When I'm at home and I'm down in the dumps, He turned my midnights into day. So I say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for Brandon.
Thank you.
Thank you for Robin. Thank you for my pastor. Thank you for the first lady. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, I thank you. I won't complain. Yeah. I won't complain.
Truly. Glory. truly giving honor to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is, who will always be. The head of my life, the captain of my salvation. Give him honor today. To the honorees, Reverend Dr. Michael Pope, his lovely wife, Sister Mary, to all the clergy members, deacons, officers of this great church. I bring you greetings from the Levi First Missionary Baptist Church of Rand, West Virginia, where the Reverend Pastor James Jackson is the pastor. This is one of the most humbling times in my life, to see so many of my friends and so many ones that I've known throughout the years. But to God be the glory.
Amen.
For all that he has done.
Yes.
At the end of what he read for me holds true. I love the Lord.
Uh-huh.
I have been teaching Sunday school for many, many years. That is my pride and my joy. I love that, but most of all, any time that I get a chance to preach the gospel. And my mind rolls back to the days when I was here at St. Paul. What was not mentioned, I used to be the janitor here. I cleaned the church, I cut the grass, I unplugged toilets, I got up in this, you see those highlights up there?
Yeah.
I scaled the rafters and would change those lights.
Yes, sir.
And my pride of being a member here, seeing such dear people as Miss Manchin.
Yes.
I give credit to her simply because she brought a lot to the church. She would check you, and one thing that the Apostle Paul, when writing to Timothy, he said, and you better not come in here unprepared, because she would call you out and say, honey, you need to go home and read your lesson. And I took that with me because that was so important. He says, study and show thyself approved unto God. For a workman needeth not be ashamed, rightly.
Right.
Do y'all want to have church this morning? Are you here? I came here and I came with the knowledge of knowing that a man that I adore, a man that I respect, a man that has come a long way, brought this church a mighty long way.
Yes, sir.
And it was an honor, and I said, he could have chosen so many more eloquent speakers and that would do such a great job, but he chose me. But God. It was not his doing, because when he told me that what he wanted me for, and I thought to myself, wow. But I said yes. Because I knew from that point on it was nobody but the Lord.
Yes, sir.
And so giving honor to him and to a dear friend who made his way out after being in the hospital after losing a loved one, his beautiful wife of 60 some years, over 65 years. But he told me, I'm going to make my way out. If God allows me, I'm going to be here, Brother Sonny. And he said, I will do my best. And when I walked across the street, there he was. Coming into the church. Amen. That meant a lot.
Yes, sir. Now,
was at the hospital visiting the other day, and a dear friend, and I call him a brother, and we've been together for a long time, Brother Lewis Farmer. He said, I said, are you getting out anytime soon? He said, I hope to be there to see you preach on Sunday. Yeah. God made a way.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Then, while I was there, the curtain was pulled and I could not see. And he said, Bill Tabor is in the bed next to me. I'm going to take my time because all of this ties in to the man that God has placed in your life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But he said, that's Bill Tabor over there. And I said, does he know you? Will he know me? He said, yes. So after spending some time with Brother Lewis and his lovely wife, I prayed with them and I went over to talk to Brother Tabor. And to my surprise, after hearing the condition, I did not expect what God had placed before me. And I said, Brother Tabor, yeah. Do you know who I am? Well, yeah, I know who you are. I said, then open your eyes and look before you say anything. My eyes are open. But the whole time I'm dealing with this and I'm praising the Lord because he said, I said, then who am I? He said, you're clear. You're Rabbi Sherrod. And I said, well, I declare. But praise be to God, because I had gotten a report that he would not know me. And he said, I know you by your voice. We're going to get there after a while, but I have to thank God. You may be looking at the clock. You may be looking at Kronos. You worried about what time you get home, what time you go eat, what time. But this is God's day. This is the pastor day. This is Kairos time. If you have to leave, just wave your Baptist finger and go on about your business. But we're going to have church in here today. Amen. Because we are on Kairos time. That is God's time. And when he say it's enough, it's enough. But until then. I love your theme today. I did not go with that. But Pastor left it open to me that I might choose what I thought would be appropriate for this time. And the topic that I will be sharing with you this afternoon, this morning still, the journey. Look where he bought us from. I'm trying my best to keep from crying, Jerry. I used to laugh at my brother Ron all the time simply because he cried all the time. Cry, baby. We even tied handkerchiefs together and started pulling them out one anniversary, just kept pulling and pulling and pulling. But now I understand. When I think about the goodness of the Lord, my God, my God.
Yes, sir.
the journey. Look where he brought us from. I will be dealing with three particular scriptures today. I will be starting out with the book of Isaiah, the sixth chapter. Then we will move to John, the 21st chapter, around the 15th through the 17th verse. Then we will close prayerfully with your theme coming from Psalms 103. Mighty powerful scripture, but in dealing with this, when the pastor called, I said, we were sharing some time prior to coming out to the wonderful, beautiful homegoing of Sister Leah Smith. And I began to share with the pastor the moment that he called me. What I like about him, he's a man that handles business and he does not wait for someone else. You know, when you get so high up, you normally have your secretary or someone under you to do your calling and you don't talk to the pastor. This is a one-on-one type of individual, a man that I truly respect, admire, and pattern my life after, Pastor Pope. And so in the book of Isaiah, the sixth chapter, and I tell my Sunday school class all the time, I'm now with the adult Sunday school, but my practice is I tell them all the time, BYOB. See, back in the day, you knew exactly what that meant when you were invited to a party. Come on now. You sitting there like you've never, ever, you've been saved all your life. BYOB. But it's important that you know that the word that's being presented to you is the word of God. And the only way that you know that it is the word of God is that you be wise.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And so, in talking to Pastor Pope, I talk to Jerry every day. And if I don't, there's something wrong. And I always ask him after service, what Pastor Pope preached on. And he said he came from the book of Isaiah. I said, oh my God. I can't believe it, because that is when the moment that Pastor called me, and this is the truth, I'm standing in God's house. Confirmation is what you look for in anything that you do. And he said he came from the sixth chapter of Isaiah. I said, that's the same passage that God has given me. I'm working on the sermon. He has called me to be the speaker of the hour at his anniversary, and I do not take that lightly. From the time he called, from the time that I got up to speak this morning, God has been working with me. Do you know God show you things? Do you know God is always working in your life? The Bible says he walks with me. He talks with me. You ought to have that relationship with God, knowing, and he tells me. He tells me some things. So he even as early as this morning, he showed me some things. And I'm going to share it with you. And when I get to, if I forget and get ahead of myself, when I get to John, the 21st chapter, if I have not shown you, told you, you say, what did he say? Because it's important that you understand what's going on. And so what I am saying today is, when I read Isaiah the sixth chapter and began to prepare my sermon that I have here that I know I'm not going to use,
But I had to write it down. I dealing with God, he just kept showing me scriptures and telling me the things that he wanted me to say, the things that I should know. And so when I looked at this scripture, it said in the year that King Uzziah died. See, Pastor may have made emphasis, he may have emphasized about Uzziah, but I'm not here to talk about Uzziah. I'm talking about the man of God, because Isaiah was only his focal point. That was his point of reference, so you could know, we could know, the year that Isaiah is talking about. Yes, Isaiah said in the year that Uzziah, it doesn't get important until you look at the rest of that verse. Yes. And I also, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne. Look at this. He said he was high and he was lifted up. Y'all don't get it. He is going into his ministry right there. The Lord has spoken to him. The Lord is showing him things. He has taken him into heaven, and he said unto him, I saw. What did you see, Isaiah? I saw the Lord. He was sitting on a throne. He was high. And he was lifted up. Can I get a witness today? Y'all don't want to have church, because this is a calling. I'm dealing with this because this is tying into your pastor. And he began to tell you the things that he was able to see. But I'm going to skip on down through that, because he's dealing with seraphims and cherubims. You do know that those are angels, right? Yeah. You know those are angels with authority. You know that when he saw seraphims, I want you to keep that in mind. Because I'm going to drop down to verse 5. Yeah. Because he tell you all this going on when he see the Lord. And these seraphims are moving about. He says they are flying. And he says that they are crying. And they cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy. He's putting you in the position to know that you are in the realm of holiness. This is no plaything. And that's why it's so important that you understand, when a pastor, you may think the church called a pastor, but God sent you a pastor. There's a difference. Some are sent and then some just went. Y'all gonna get that when you get home. But I'm telling you about a man that's sent. How do you know he sent? Because in verse 5, stay with me, stay with me. I hope you got your Bible. I hope you're paying attention. Because in verse 5, he after holy, 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 and the earth is full of glory, then he goes and he talks about the post of the temple shaking, and he's talking about all of these things. But then he says something about himself. And I was telling Pastor Polk about it. He read back. He hollered, whoa, am I? That means that you understand, and you're in constant communication with the Lord. You understand that what you're about to partake of is holiness. Yeah. And he says in verse 5, he said, then said I, whoa, it's me, for I am. Wait a minute.
Undone.
For I am undone. Stay with me. This is that journey from the time that he left. I think something like 800 to 1,000 miles, if I'm not mistaken.
738 one way.
You multiply 738 times 2 times 24, even if he go home twice a year. You're going to get the point after a while. But he says, who am I? Mm-hmm. Who is me? Woe is me, for I am undone. Because I am
a man of unclean lips. In other words, my brothers and sisters, he's taking this serious. He's walking into this with his eyes wide open, and he understands one thing. I cannot go in the way that I am. God has shown me something about me while I'm here that I need to change. You don't go in just any kind of way into holiness and righteousness to pastor God's people. He says, I am a man of unclean lips. Yes, he didn't stop right there. He didn't stop there. He says, not only am I a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. My Lord, my Lord. Take time and let that sink in. You understand that you are in the holiness of God. You understand that you have a calling on your life. You also understand the seriousness of all you have to do is go back and check. The reason he was telling you about Uzziah is the fact that Uzziah went out of his realm and did things he was not supposed to, and he was punished. Right. Yeah. Am I right about it?
Yes. Yeah.
You see, when God checks you, he checks you. And so he did not want to fall into this. And so he says, I know I'm a man of unclean lips. And I dwell among people that are just like me. Well, what you trying to say, Pastor? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. Because in order for God to send you, he is telling you, get your house in order. He says, well, I am dropping down, and he said, God is looking for something. He's looking for something in this man. So he says that to get me right, the seraphim went to the altar. Got a hot coal. And he placed it on my lips. Something had to change. Something in me had to change. So he said, and he placed it on my lips. And it said, you are cleansed. Your sins are forgiven. And so he is working his way into his life. But that's not the only thing that he's doing. Because after cleansing him, God is having a conversation. And he's about to put him on his mission journey. What is he trying to say here? He led me to a place to let me know where I am going. But he said, also I heard a voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? After his cleansing, he says that he said unto me, I said, whom shall I send? And who shall go for us? Not me. I want you to understand, having a little Bible lesson here this morning, I want you to understand God never said, even in the beginning, he told, when he was about to do his creation, he said, let us. God created the heavens and the earth, and when he got to man, he said, let us. Oh, y'all don't see where I'm going with this. God has his hand in it. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit is always, but the three are one. But let us make man. That's what he says right here. And then he says, let us, who shall we send? And who shall I send? And who will go for us? Then Pastor Polk answered. Then said, Pastor Polk said, here am I.
Yes, sir. send me. God said that I hear you, but there are some things you have to do. See, I'm going to jump right quick over to Genesis 12, if you don't mind. I didn't give you that scripture, but in preparing him, he said unto him, there's something that you must do. You see, Pastor Pope was looking around the city. He knew that he is ready. He's looking around the town and the community and even outside the city in the state. I know that I'm going. The Lord has already told me he's sending me, but where is he going to send me? He thought he's going to be right there in Kansas City, Missouri. But the Lord said, I have some news. You said you want to go. It is my job. So if you would look at the 12th chapter Genesis, the very first verse, I believe it is, Pastor, am I right about it? Yes. What did God say? And God said, huh? Wait a minute. Get thee out of thy country, out of the city of Kansas City. Leave behind, what did it say, Pastor? Read it out for me. Huh? Leave your folk. See, folk know you. They know all your habits. They know all your bad habits. They know everything you've been into. I'm sending you somewhere else. You cannot pastor. You cannot do an effective work because they're going to always hide me. Come on over. Let's do this once again. So I'm sending, leave your mama. Leave your daddy. Yes, leave all your people. Yeah. Brother Sonny, he's dealing with him here. Yeah. And so he said, I want you to leave all of that, and I'm going to send you. Here's his promise. Uh-huh. What did he say? I'm going to do what to you, Pastor? Huh? Where are you going to send you? Yeah. To another country. He said, you leave them that I will show you. Yeah. Pastor Polk had a question. If I leave everybody behind, but what about this brown-eyed beauty that I so love? I'm going to get to this, and when we get to John, I'm going to get to this. But he asked a question nearly. What about my baby? There you go. It's in the book. Go to Genesis 2 and 27, and it says, therefore shall a man. Oh, y'all don't hear me. Y'all don't want to have church in here. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, cleave to his wife, and one, and the two shall become. He sent them here as a pair. He made them leave everything behind them for a reason, because he knew that he was sending him to a country or to a place where they had to lean and depend on one another. He's working at marriage. He's working at unity. He's working it for the purpose of the church. Amen. Oh, we're getting ready to move on. I know you're tired already, but I'm just now getting wound up. I'm just now getting, because it's so good. But then when you go to the book of John, the 21st chapter, there are things that have to be answered. You really don't understand what God is doing in a pastor's life, because all you can say, well, we paying him for it, he ought to be doing it. You don't understand the power of God. You don't understand the hurt, the pain, and all that he's going through. And he sent him that wife so that she could be right there to hear him in his worst moments, in his time when his heart is hurting, when he just don't understand. He's pacing the floor. He's up all night long worrying over people that's mistreating him. That's why he sent Mary. That's why she's the love of his life. Even the times when she say, pack up and let's go home. I know it happened. You don't have to tell me. I know it did. I can't say what I want to because we're in a diverse group. But I have some words. I know what she's saying. They're not worth it. But God said, hang on in it. You go ahead and you soothe him. You go ahead and you talk with him. But the thing you have to understand, you're not going anywhere. It's not over until God says it's over. 23 years down the road, and God is still saying, I have work for you to do. When I was in his office, and before I get to this next, I was in his office. And people just take everything. You take your pastor for granted. I walked in his office, and I have known him a many a year, and I took one look and saw pain all in his face. I said, Pastor Polk, when I drove up, I looked at the new section of the church. I looked at the parking lot. I looked at all that God has allowed you, and he said, not without a price. Am I right about it, Pastor? Did you? But I saw the pain, because he had been taken away from his family. He had taken his wife from her family, and he had come to a place to do God's work and his will. But it cost. And the Lord told you it would. He did not put you out there and tell you it was going to be easy. He said, if you follow me, pick up your cross. And you're going to have disappointment. You're going to have misunderstanding. You're going to have people talk about you. You're going to have people to criticize you. You're going to have people to just say anything, any kind of way, and treat you just any kind of way. But you have a cross. Must Jesus bear the cross alone? And all the world go free. No, there is a cross. When you're in the pastorate, there is a cross. For everyone, and there is a cross for me.
Yes.
I'm hurrying along, but at the same time, I'm taking my time.
All right.
Because then in John, the 21st chapter, Jesus' boys had been fishing all night long. Didn't catch a thing. Have you ever been like that, Pastor?
Yes, sir.
You go fishing, and I'm so proud. I have to stop and just let it be known. I am so proud simply because I saw these people. And another prayer was answered because I said, you have to show me the way. You have to show me what you want me to say about this pastor. Those young people came up here and they performed. It's gonna show up right here in John, the 21st chapter. Because he asked Pastor prior to sending him, and once he got in here, Michael, do you love me? Do y'all know what Michael stands for, by the way? No? You better look it up. No, I'll go ahead and tell you. God's gift. Then he said, Michael, do you love me? Jesus, you know I love you. Feed my lambs. Wait a minute. Before he went into all of that, he fixed them a breakfast, Brother Andrew. I was given an apron this morning, inducted me into the Brotherhood Hall of Fame. So he gave me an apron. But do you love me? There are things that you ought to be able to do. This is a man that worked with his hands. This is a man that not only has the vision, but he get out there and he make the vision happen. I'm not saying he'd do it alone, but he has people, workers, he has people in place to make sure things are done. I witnessed it this morning. I'll get to it in a minute. But he said, do you love me? I didn't know what that meant, Pastor, why he showed me this scripture. Do you love me? Then feed my lamb. After feeding them and having, knowing Peter, this is his third time showing himself.
Yeah.
After his resurrection. And he's asking a question, the same question he asked Pastor Pope. Do you really love me? Then there's a job that you must have to do. You must do this. You must feed my lamb. You must feed my sheep. You must feed my sheep. He has to keep telling them, Lord, you know I love you. Then feed them. So I said, what does that mean? I'm going to say this, but I really don't get to understand. And then I was sitting in his office. Show you how the Lord show you things. I was sitting in his office and Brother Gabe came in and he had all kinds of questions. Pastor Polk answered his questions, but then his assistant came in. You remember I said, feed, feed, feed?
Yeah.
He's all about teaching. He's all about showing. He's all about making you knowledgeable and telling you, you are accountable for these things. To feed means that you are training them. To feed means that you are showing them the right way to go about things. And I should not have to repeat myself. God was showing me all of this. So he looked at Brother Andrew and he said, did I not make myself clear? I'm talking about feeding. Telling your people the way to go, how to act, how to do things, and the right way to do them. Yeah. Can I get a witness? Amen. Talking about that, talking about God working in this man's life. Yeah. God working and you should have seen the look on his face. He chastised them in a way that they understood. I have told you, I have showed you, I have made clear. And now on the day that you are... accountability. I bet you won't make that mistake again. Because God had put in him the importance of me training you just like a mother and a father train up a child in the way that they should go. These are children to him. Even though they're especially the young lamb right here, because they need training, they need to be sure-footed and have knowledge of the way to go about serving the Lord. So he had this look and he said, I have to answer to God because he has instructed me to feed my people. I saw the little people, God's confirmation again. Yeah. They're up here, but he made sure, and I see the gentleman in the back, I think it's Tomas, but they had the little children up here doing exactly what God had commanded him to do, train them up in the way that they should give them. I heard the young man and the young man get up here and sing. He said, put them in church, give them a reason to come, and show them. That's what he's talking about when he say, feed my people. Do you love me? But he has to say, do you love me more than you love these? He has Sister Mary up there. Wait. Now, wait a minute. Well, Lord, I do. I love you with all. How did he say you have to love the Lord? With all. You didn't hear me. You have to love the Lord with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul. Yeah, your everything. You have to love the Lord. Yes, Mary, you come second. You beautiful, he loved you to death, but the Bible says that he must love God, love his work, and you're to understand that, and I know you do, but you have to love him with everything, your whole, your total being. Young man, you headed down a road, and more than likely you're going to follow right along the footsteps of the way you've been taught, and one day you're going to be married, but you need to understand God is first. Yes, sir. And that was one of the things that happened to me early in my ministry when I knew I was going to be called. I went to the church, and there was a sign they had made up to structure of the church, how God operates, and it had God, the people, and the pastor. I say, Lord, have mercy.
That has to come down.
Yeah.
That has to come down.
God sent Pastor Polk to pastor, y'all better understand this, his people. God speaks directly to him. And then he tells him to tell you all to follow me as I follow Christ. Just want to set some things in order so that you can't say I was ignorant of what I was. No, you don't come before. God don't download a thing to you. That's why you've been walking in the wilderness for 40 years, ask the Hebrew boys. You've been walking around in a circle what should have taken just a few days. Here you are for 40 years because the man of God that you did not respect. The man of God that was trying to lead you the right way, what did you do? I know better way. He can't tell me what to do. I know what I'm talking about. I pastor one of the hardest churches. I don't care who's in here. Take it wherever you want to. Everybody should have had to go and pastor where I pastored. There's a reason I only lasted 4.5 years. But God sent me. I did my duty, and when it was time to go, I had to go. But here he is, 23 years later, still struggling and straining and trying to lead God's people in the right way. And for that, to God be the glory. Do you love me? Yes, I do, Lord. Then you have to feed them. You have to show me what it is. And you give them responsibility. You give them knowledge. And then you hold them accountable for everything that they do. I heard it. I saw the look. I know that you are going through some things. I know that you're going through a lot. I know it's not easy. And your heart is really going back to your people in Kansas City, because you had to go down there not only to bury your loved one, your true heart and someone that you truly love, but you had to eulogize her. And I know the pain is great. But there is no pain that God cannot heal. You know that, being a preacher of God, but sometimes you need a person to come to you, another man of God, to lift you up, hold you up, pray for you, and tell you it's going to be all right. God said that everything is going to be all right. Oh, we're getting ready to come to a close. But when I began to look at that scripture that he has chosen for his anniversary, I believe it's Psalms 103. See, through all of the pain, through all of the hurt, through all that he's going through, even when everything looked like I should go back home and I should go see my people, here I am with these people. But then the Lord showed him his reason for being here. And as I began to close, finally I want to say that the pastor looked up and through all of his hurt, his pain, and all that he's going through, he says, "Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me." Oh, where are you going with it? Well, I want to tell you, after 23 years of fighting the battle, after 23 years of walking and talking with the Lord, after 23 years of doing everything he can to bring people to the Lord, walking and talking and going to the hospital, visiting with people, and I want to tell you that he looked up and he saw the glory of the Lord. He said, "Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me," because he says, "Oh my soul, forget not all of his benefits." He tells you that the Lord's been mighty good to me. No matter what I had to go through, the Lord is my all in all. No matter what I go through, the Lord is my everything. I'm gonna hold on. I said I'm gonna hold on. I'm gonna hold on to his unchanging hand. You have to keep the faith. No matter how dark it gets, you have to hold on. No matter how down in the dumps you get, hold on. You don't know what the future holds. But Pastor, I know who holds your hand. Keep right on walking. Keep right on talking. Keep right on preaching. But to never let go. Brother Sonny used to sing that song all the time. That God is my all in all. I have so many songs as I was preparing my message that God had. Brother Sonny, that's appropriate to, and I wish you felt like singing. He keeps on blessing me. over and over again. He said, I strayed away. So many times, many, many times I just didn't do right. But you know the Lord keeps right on. He come in and he lie down with you each and every night. And then he began to sing that song, What He's Done For Me. I can't forget. I don't know about you, but when I look back over my life and I see where he has brought me from, when I see how he has blessed me, I shall not forget what he's done for me. And then after, oh, there it is. There it is. You gonna sing a little bit of it?
He keeps on blessing me.
Yes, he does. Come on now.
Oh, Lord. He keeps on blessing me. Yes, he does. He keeps on blessing me. Yes, over and over and over. Over and over again.
Yeah.
Help me say it one more time, clear.
He keeps on
blessing.
I'm
ain't nobody.
The Lord,
oh Lord,
he showers them down.
He keeps on blessing. Ain't nobody but my friend Jesus. Over and over and over.
Yes, sir.
Over and over again. Well, the verse goes on to say, what a gift we have to share his love. And independent we live on nothing but his grace. Yesterday is gone. But today he holds out his hand. But you gotta do what? Over again. Oh, he keeps on blessing me over and over and over and over. He keeps on blessing. Ain't nobody but my friend. Many, many, many times. Many, 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 many times. Church, I know I just didn't do right. But he gave me the strength to go on through the day. And he watches over me every night. Hey, won't you help me say? Nobody but my friend Jesus.
He keeps
on. Yeah, yes he does, yes he does. He keeps on blessing me. I said over and over. Over and over. Over and over, over and over, over and over. Over and over. Come and say it just one more time. Over and over. Again. Again.
That's what the Lord does. He just told me, I don't think I will be able to make it. I said, if you just trust in the Lord, trust in Him, He will make a way. That's all right. That's all right. We're coming to the close, but nothing but really set this service off until you hear from your pastor. After all that he's been through, the road has been rough, the going has been tough. He said the hills have been hard to climb, but what he did not say is God carried him through the valleys. See, the mountains are high, but Lord, when you get down, that's when he said, I'll carry you. I know you're not able to walk. I know you're hurting. I know the pain is there. So I'm going to carry you. You're going to walk through the valley. And, but you have to understand the Lord is. Yes, sir. All right. That's what the Lord did. That's a sign, my brothers and sisters, you don't know what an honor and a privilege it is to be, to stand here today, and what it is to speak a man of God. But he's not through. You know what? Through all that he's been through, I talked to him, and he said, I still have a praise. Am I right about it? Come on, Pastor Pope. You know you've been through it, but I still. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Oh, this is church. This is church. Oh, my God. Stand to your feet. Give God the glory. I still have a praise. When you've been through it.
I've been through the fire. I've been through the fire.
Anybody ever been through the fire?
I've been through the flood.
This is what happened to me.
Broken in pieces. And left all alone.
But I got good news on tonight.
But through it all, God bless me.
Won't He bless you?
Inside of me. let's praise him in the house. Come on, I dare you to give him glory. I dare you to give him honor, because he's worthy.
Yes,
sir.
Give him your hand and guard your heart. If there be one that's outside the ark of safety who would like to know the Lord for the free period of pardoning of their sins, now is the time. Because heaven is going to be just like this. Oh, what a joy it's going to be in heaven and to be with the Lord when all the pain, the suffering, everything is over. Going to be singing and having church like this in heaven. I know you're good. I want you to know I love you, dear. Sister Mary, the road has been rough. I love you. God has truly smiled on you, and you still have a praise inside of you. May God bless you. I'll put it back in the hands. Pray that the message has been a blessing. I've had a ball. Left most of it out, but I think what God wanted to be said has been said.
Amen.
And so that's all we care about.
Yes.
That you know that God is smiling.
Yes.
He's going to continue to walk with you. He's going to continue to talk and to care for you and your family and see you through every situation. May God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. I put it back into the hands. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, sir. Wonderful word on this morning. And now, before we leave, I would like to, I'd like to have Sister Crowley and Brother Tomas come forward for the presentation of gifts for Pastor and Miss Pope. Let's give God a hand, Lord. that prayer. And so now I would ask Deacon Epps to come forward for the prayer over Pastor and Miss Polk. After that, you will hear remarks from Brother Deacon Brian Law.
I'd like to say good afternoon. It's a privilege to be able to be here today for this occasion. I think this is probably the third or fourth year in a row that I've been asked to do this prayer for Pastor and Sister Pope, and I count it as a great honor to be asked to be able to do that, to be able to express not only my feelings and for what God has presented to St. Paul, but for the church's feelings as well. We have been presented with a great gift of two individuals that were on his mind for this church from way back when, before we even knew it. They were already on schedule to be here for such a time as this. Even though this is the day, emphasis on this is the day that God has made, and he had designed this day and this purpose. And unknowns to us and unknowns to Pastor and Sister Murray, this was designed from the start. This is God ordained, and I just appreciate it so much that he pointed them in this direction and said, go, rise up and go. This is my assignment for you and my gift for the people of St. Albans. And I'm just so thankful for everything that you've done and for everything that I have seen and witnessed in my years here. I noticed during the song that you were singing a few minutes ago that I noticed in the back that the young ladies were standing, and they were so enthused to be singing with their pastor and celebrating him. And that's always good, you know. Your youth and your young people, when your young people are into your pastor and your first lady, you know you've really got something, and God is blessing you. So this is Pastor Wallace Hartsfield. Of course, I don't have to tell you who he is. That Pastor Polk's father in the ministry would always say, Mike, you know what to do, and you know to do the right thing. Pastor told about when Pastor Hartsfield told him, said, son, said, it's always better to be invited up to the pulpit than to be called down out of the pulpit. And so Pastor said, I always cherished that, and I always remembered my place in the ministry. And as Brother Cliff was speaking earlier about the assignment of the younger ministers and the people who are new in this call of God, that basically it's always good to have somebody who can call you down, who can say things to you that basically nobody else could say. And so just so thankful to have a pastor who can do it and who can say it in such a fashion and still can be the word of God and also can be the friend of his congregation. That's so important. And Sister Murray, the way that you're cherished with the Sunday school and the youth and with the ladies and the women, it's just a blessing. And you are here along with your pastor. You are two in one. You know, you are entwined together and inseparable. And I'm just so thankful that God has given us that type of ministerial partnership here at St. Paul. I remember 23 years ago when I picked up Pastor from, I first of all called him and found out what time he was coming. I went to the airport and I was waiting, and he got off the plane. And I'll say this again, I say it every time. He came off wearing his hat and wearing his black suit and everything, and I looked and I said, Martin Luther King. And so that's who he looked like, and that's who he reminded me of, Martin Luther King. And so just so good to have you here. And as Cliff said, look where he bought me from. He had you in his mind 739 miles from West Virginia when he called you without you knowing your destination. He said, get up and go. Where am I going? I'll tell you when you get there and I will inform you. So basically you're here in a place that you didn't even know existed. And so we're just so thankful to have you. And now my prayer for you. Heavenly Father, I just offer tribute for my pastor, Michael A. Polk Sr. and his wife, Mary. I thank you so much sincerely from the bottom of my heart that you have sent this reverent, holy man here to St. Paul. Someone who has the endearment of the church on his mind at all times. It's always good to be able to know that you have someone who is not trying to claim glory for themselves, but always has in mind the well-being of his flock, of the church, of you. Because remember, we are the church. And when I speak in terms of the church, I'm not speaking in terms of the building, even though and the surroundings, even though he has done wondrous things here at this church. But I'm speaking in terms of the flock that he loves so well. And for 23 years, that's a tribute to be able to be in a position and still be loved by the people. So, God, I just thank you. I thank you for your insight and for your positioning and for not only everything that you do, but for this one special thing that you did. You know, we don't want to just take things as a whole and lump them in. This is something that is special to St. Paul Baptist Church in St. Albans, West Virginia, that you have sent this man and woman of God to be in place for a time like this, for this day. And so I thank you, God, in a mighty way. But we're going to lift you up, give you the honor, the glory, and the praise. Even while we're praising the man of God here, we know that all praise and honor and glory goes to you. And so we just thank you for caring enough about us to give us one of your special gifts. And so thank you, Lord, for leading this man here to St. Paul Baptist Church along with his lovely wife, Mary. And we thank you, Lord, for the 23 years of service that he has given. And we thank you, Lord, for the 23 more years that we will see him in our presence. So we just thank you, Lord, giving you honor, giving you glory, and giving you praise. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Can we say amen?
Amen.
Can we say amen one more time?
Amen.
Can we say amen one more time?
Amen.
Now can we get a hallelujah, thank you, God? Pastor, I want to shake your hand, hug
you. I was looking around for my deacon this morning. I didn't see myself. Where's my deacon at?
Uh-huh.
Here he is.
I was in the corner.
Amen. 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 Let's put our hands together one more time. Amen. 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 We want to, the Pastor's Anniversary Committee wants to let you know also that the fellowship doesn't stop here. Amen. We're looking forward to having a breaking bread together following service at Mediterranean Breeze. Amen. They're already looking for us. Amen. They probably have the patio reserved for us. Amen. As they've done for the past few years. But we thank God and we want to encourage everyone to continue on in the fellowship as we break bread together following service. Amen. Amen. With that being said, I thank God for all who are on the anniversary committee. You have your program and on the back are the names. Amen. I just thank God for all those who made our anniversary weekend. Amen. A success. Amen. From the top to the bottom. Amen. And everything in between was, like Reverend Bell would say, gooder and gooderer. And I thank God. I thank God for that. Thank God for our MC. Amen. Also, amen. Amen.
Amen. And I conclude my remarks by saying I love my pastor. I love my first lady. Amen. Sister Mary. Amen. And I'm glad that I can serve with them, beside them, and follow his lead. Amen. Amen. And he knows that I have his back as well. Amen. 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 And I pray that the church, amen, has the same sentiment in their hearts. Amen? Amen. Amen. And I just thank God for everyone being here today. And I'll leave the remarks to Brother Pastor and Sister Mary at this time. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I said, you raise me up. God, raise me up. St. Paul, church, community, friends, it has been amazing. Mm-hmm. Yesterday and today has been absolutely amazing. And I want to start out by saying, I heard Reverend McDavid, I mentioned it yesterday, say at his graduation, I have a basket full of thank yous. I have a basket full of gratitude today, church. And I want to take it from Luke, the first chapter, where Mary sings her song and she says, my soul does magnify the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in my Savior. Reverend Sherrod, that message you gave us today has a special place for Pastor and I. That was his first initial sermon when he was called into the ministry. Here I am, Lord, send me. So you were right on point. Thank you. My soul does magnify the Lord, church, because I have Miss Manchin as my role model. I have Brother Sonny as my role model. You are the pillars of this church. And I thank you because I stand on your shoulders. I thank you. My soul does magnify the Lord. St. Paul, when I look at you, you are my family. My soul does magnify the Lord, and I thank you because you guys have been through a lot with us. You have supported us. You have loved for us. You have cared for us. And then recently you shared the pain with us in the death of our granddaughter. But our soul does magnify the Lord because we are committed here, and you guys have shown us the love that we need, and you have cared for us. And then I look at the ladies' ministry. Yesterday, you just loved on me, and you guys were so gracious and wonderful, and the outpouring of love and support, and we have been through a lot. We've taken trips, we've done so many things to the glory of God, and my soul does magnify the Lord. And then when I see the young people stand up here and praise God and sing to the glory of God, and I see Angel, who came up here in the church as a small girl, now she's bringing her kids, my soul does magnify the Lord, and it lets me know that everything we're doing here is worth it. God called us here. My soul does magnify the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. So St. Paul, it hasn't been easy, but my soul does magnify the Lord. But it has been rewarding, and my soul does magnify the Lord. And I praise God for every minute, every hour, every day. And as I have retired, everybody knows, it's been all over Facebook everywhere. I've been so excited, but I stand here today and I say, here I am, Lord, send me. Here I am. So St. Paul, thank you. Thank you. Everything has been so amazing. Yesterday, so amazing. You guys are great. You're my family, and I love you.
Wow. So many things that need to be said. Let me just start by saying I love you because I do. Love God
and I love God's people.
Yes.
And that's one of the things. I never want to bring dishonor to God. I never want to bring dishonor to my family. I never want to bring dishonor to St. Paul. Amen. I love God, and I love God's people.
Amen.
Listen, great day on yesterday. Wow. My goodness, you all really put that together.
The covering.
That was just over the top. Thank you all so much. Thank you for being kind to my wife. Nobody has to be kind to you. Thank you so much. And then this anniversary committee. Wow, you know, Deacon Smith and Mom Ann, they would be on that committee every year. And so they're honorary members there. But she's here, and she's just going to make sure that things are done for the pastor. But listen, I couldn't have a better assistant pastor. I really couldn't.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you, Reverend Andrew McDavid, he knows how to get it done. He really does. He knows how to get it done, and his wife knows how to get it done. They two are a dynamic duo. And I thank God for them, very special people in our lives. Also, the chairman, my goodness, this young man's got skills. And I've always admired that when he was over there in Madison. And then the next thing I know, we got him here, he and his wife, and just doing an outstanding job, his mom. Wow, we love God's people. We really do. All of these years, you heard my wife make mention of the pillars of our church, Mom Manchin and Brother Sonny. We thank God for both of you, how you've been available for us throughout the years. And all of our hearts are heavy for Brother Sonny. And wow, I didn't expect him to be here today. But didn't he sing with power today? My goodness. He did. He dug down deep. He came up praising God. So, I am just so thankful to our youth, to everybody here. You know, this is our church. It really is. It is a great remnant. And we thank God for the ministry gifts that are here in this church. We've got sisters, and then Brother Robert said we got sisters. But they could get it done. Carla, Donna, Edith, and Kathleen. Wow, we just thank God for all of you all. Everything you do, we're so thankful to the people of God. Minister Johnson's here today, he and his wife. Just glad to have them home. I know you come to see Mom, but on this day, you came to the house, and thank you all so much. You wouldn't have it any other way, though. I know you was at Sunday school today, wasn't you? All right. Praise God for you. But listen. The message was on point today, Reverend Sherrod. Thank you. It wasn't no accident. God knew that this day would be here. And listen, you definitely have to be called by God to do this. You got to be called by God. And no doubt about it, I know that we're called by God. And I'm so thankful to serve in this work with all of the deacons. My goodness, Jerry. Like a brother. Uh-huh. And Brandon's here today. Robin's here today. All right. So these young guys that sung today, my goodness. You know, after I was asked to sing the song, you know what I wanted to do, Aiden? I wanted to drop the mic. Good job on the day, you and Gabriel. Gabriel's been here since he's 8 years old, so wow, look at him now. Who would have thought? Good to see Russell here today. Tony, wow, all of our guests here today. All right, Brother Wayne, I think you've been here, what, three Sundays straight? Four? Okay. All right, all right. And then to have Brother Farmer out of the hospital. Yeah. He's just special in my life, and I thank God for him, he and his wife. I tell you, listen, my minister of music, my goodness, he tickled them keys. One more thing. You know, this is the truth. When we go away to do our ministry, wow, they love St. Paul. They really do. They love our choir. My goodness, we were in Madison last Sunday, and the Lord just blessed our people, and we were able to minister and that kind of thing. So I've been through the hills and the hollers and all these places with St. Paul. I didn't even know West Virginia existed. True statement. But I do now. And I'm a West Virginian because I got a mortgage. All right. But thank you all. Love you. Appreciate you. And if I've left anything out, forgive me. But I love everybody.
And to close out, we will have. Oh, sorry, one more thing. And to close out, I would like to have Reverend Clifford Sherrod give us the benediction.
To God be the glory for all that He has done. Thank you so much for enduring that brown-eyed beauty that He calls with much pride Mary. We thank God for you guys. Look where He has brought us from. Enough has been said. God bless you. Those of you who are able to stand to your feet. Oh, Lord, as we come to the close of this service, Lord, all we can do is say thank you. Lord, you have shown yourself, and to God be the glory. We are not here on our efforts, but all because we lean and depend on you. And Lord, it's been a glorious day. So Lord, bless as only you can. Bless the pastor and his wife if they move forward. Those ones that struggled and strained and made their way out, Lord, thank you. For the songs of Zion, we thank you. But Lord, as we come to the close of this day, let us never, ever, ever forget how your grace and mercy carries us. Now as we dismiss, Lord, from this service, never from your grace, never from your mercy, Lord, keep us all in your care. Now unto him who is able to present us faultless. To the all-wise and mighty God be grace and dominion henceforth and forever. And the church say amen. 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 God bless you. Love you. Amen.